So I will be talking indeed about machine learning for chemical engineering in general, but indeed, as Cornel said, the focus will be on drug discovery. And before we start off with machine learning or chemical engineering, I just really want to introduce you to what a molecule is. I know most of you probably know it, but we have a very broad audience. So let's just go back to Wouter's talk, where he was talking about neutrinos. And when you zoom out a bit of neutrinos, you can go towards an atom. And when you zoom out of an atom and you combine different atoms together, then we are talking about a molecule. So one of the most famous molecules that exist is water. I'm very sorry about the drawings. I didn't have a lot of time to make some slides. But water molecules, they basically look like that. So we have oxygen atoms, we have hydrogen atoms, and they are connected by bonds. And water droplets, water molecules, you can find them, for example, in water droplets. And I just want to give you an idea of how small water molecules are compared to how we see the world. And for that, I will use a reference to where I grew up. So as some of you might know, I'm from Ostende and I'm deeply in love with the sea. And I can tell you that there are about as much water molecules in a water droplet as there are water droplets in the North Sea. So that's sketching an image of what a water molecule or a molecule in general looks like. So chemical engineering is much bigger than just molecules. And if we have to classify chemical engineering, we typically do that based on a scale of length, time, and complexity. And molecules, they are the smallest parts. So in my PhD research and what I mainly focus on, it's called quantum chemical calculations and kinetic modeling, where we look at those molecules and we look how they react and how they go from one molecule into another molecule into the products that we want to have in chemical industry to make other end-use products. But actually, there's much more towards chemical engineering. And you can also have, for example, CFD calculations, where people look at how flows are or how temperature profiles look like. We can have reactor design, so where we have different molecules interacting with each other, and we'll make the reactors in a way that we have the most optimum product distribution from that. And then we go a step further to pilot scale plants, and we even go further to industrial scale plants, which we have a lot in Belgium because Antwerp and Rotterdam and Amsterdam are actually the main center of Europe regarding chemical industrial plants. So my focus is really on the small part, on the molecule part and how molecules react. And this can still be done for different applications. So I listed some of the applications here. In my PhD research, I mainly focused on biofuels and process optimization. Today and in MIT, I'm mainly working on drug discovery. And actually in the rest of my PhD, I plan to go back to Ghent University next semester, so in September. And there I will be working on chemical recycling. So the recycling of our plastic waste today, how we can reuse them and how we can bring them back to new plastics. And I'm shifting focus a little bit because obviously we have to do something with all the plastic waste that we have today. And it's a really important and urgent question that we have to solve because the technologies that we have now, they basically don't work that well. But anyhow, today we'll talk a bit about drug discovery. And before I show you how machine learning actually applies to chemical engineering, I'll just tell you a little bit about machine learning in general. So the last decades, probably, machine learning really and deep neural networks, they really have like emerged in our world. Everybody's talking about artificial intelligence, and it's actually already in our world in many more places than you can imagine. So image recognition is something that's very often used. Autonomous driving, it's also starting to be used and it's going to become more common. Every time you look something up on Google Translate, you're actually using natural language processing. Also in robotics and gaming, there are really tons of applications of machine learning, and there are probably many more than you can even see on the slides. In chemical engineering, this is not the case. So the last 10 years, artificial intelligence and machine learning has started to become a reality in chemical engineering, but it's actually only the last 3 years that people really started to publish on it and to start working on it. And why is that? Because all these machine learning tools, they have been developed by computer scientists. And if you talk to a computer scientist about chemistry, it's like talking to me about computer science. You know, we don't understand each other. But now that these tools are there and these tools are well developed, we actually use some of the ideas of natural language processing, of image recognition, and we'll try to apply those in chemical engineering and the problems that we have today. So just the last couple of years, and the main applications are actually in drug discovery and are being developed at MIT and Stanford and some of the big universities. So what do we do when we talk about machine learning and chemical engineering? So one of the main things that we do is chemical property prediction. So here you can see a molecule, ibuprofen, and we'll try to predict a property of ibuprofen. And that property can be anything. It can be how soluble it is, how well it evaporates, really all kinds of different things. So this molecule, we have to convert it in some kind of molecular fingerprint, is what we call it. And it's basically a vector representation of our molecule. I'll talk a bit more about that later. And then you basically have a black box. So machine learning for many people is just a black box. For everybody, it's just a black box. And then what you get out of it is the property that we predict. So, but many of the research that we do is actually in how do we convert this molecule to something that we can feed to a neural network. So how do we convert it to this vector representation? And there are different possibilities. So here you can see some examples for ibuprofen. We want it to be in a vector format, but we also want the computer to kind of learn the chemistry behind it. So the one you probably all know from in the lab is the CAS number, but it's just a series of numbers and it contains no chemical information at all. So then you can have the chemical formula, which already has some information because you know which atoms are there. And then you have something called SMALS, which is a string representation of your molecule, where you basically have all the atoms and all the connectivity. But we even go a bit further, and in many of the applications in drug discovery, many of the early applications, we used something called Morgan fingerprints, and they basically represents the different functional groups that you have in your molecule. So many applications in drug discovery, they don't really depend on how your molecule looks like, but which groups are present in your molecule. And that's what we want to represent with these functional groups or with these Morgan fingerprints. But the last couple of years, or the last year, we actually went a bit further and we're starting from a graph-based structure. So where we have every atom featureized with some information connected by bonds, which are the edges of the graph structure. And I'll go a bit further into that later. And then the last months, people are also starting to look into 3D information and how can we use this 3D information and feed it to a neural network. But that's all very, very new. So that's the network I'm using. It's called a directed message passing neural network. Now I'm going very technical, but we'll go away from that later. So that's what I said when I meant we represent our molecules using a graph structure. So basically your atoms and your bonds are different parts of your graph and you featureize it. So for example, an atom can be characterized by its molar mass, the number of electrons, by very simple things, and the same for the bonds. And then what we'll do in a message passing neural network, there's a lot of math behind it, but what we actually do is we try to pass on information from neighboring atoms and from neighboring sites to the central atom and try to encode how the molecule looks like. But I will not go into too much detail here. But I do want to give you an example of what this kind of property prediction can do. So this molecule, it's called halicin. And what is halicin? So the group of Regina Barzilay at MIT, where we work closely together with, they tried this message passing neural network on antibiotic properties. So what they basically did is they had a whole list of molecules, some of them which had good antibiotic effects, others which didn't. And they basically trained the neural network, and they had the neural network learn molecules that have antibiotic properties. They look like that. Other ones, they look like that. So then they used that to predict for a whole set of known drug molecules. So for, it's called the Zinc database. So there are like thousands of molecules that already exist that we were already able to synthesize one day. And they checked, do they have antibiotic properties? And there were some that had, and most of them were already known or were very similar to the ones that we know now. But there were actually 20 ones that were very unique. We didn't know they had antibiotic properties. And one of them was Helicin. So they went to the lab, they tested out these 20 molecules, and Helicin was discovered to be very effective against antibiotics against bacteria. And yeah, so that's exactly what you can do with this kind of property prediction. Nobody ever thought before about Helicin as being an antibiotic, but the machine told us that it's a good potential. And in the lab, we actually confirmed that. So that's what we can do right now with machine learning and neural networks for chemical engineering, but we plan to go even further. So I told you, for this Helicin molecule, we basically screen a set of components that already exist. But the set of components that already exist, it's basically comparing the Earth to the entire galaxy, right? So there are so many molecules that nobody ever thought about, that we never synthesized before. So that's where we want to go in the next step. And that's what we call generative modeling. But before I show you how generative modeling is applied to chemical engineering or how it can be applied, let me just tell you a bit more about what generative modeling is in general. So this morning I discovered my artistic side, and I used generative modeling to make my own piano piece. So I'll give you a small demonstration of that. So that's a piano piece that I designed this morning. It's very unique. It's based on a random initiation. So nobody made this before. Something else that I did this morning was another artistic side of me, and I painted my first Van Gogh painting. And the thing about generative modeling and about neural networks is they can also be very creative. So if you ask it to create a rhino horn, that's actually an image that you get. So this kind of creativity and this kind of inventiveness, we want to bring also to chemical engineering. So the last thing I tried was, there is this generative modeling in fashion as well. So I asked the machine to make me a dress, and that's the dress that I got. It's very pretty. I just need now a robot to make it and send it to me. So, but keep that in mind for my next slide. So in generative modeling, we can now also apply that to chemical engineering. And in pharmaceutical companies, we can have, for example, this structure that's identified as very active against viruses in this case. But we cannot use it as a drug because there are a lot of other things that we have to consider in drug discovery. For example, the drug has to be very soluble. It has to have low toxicity. You want it to bind very well. You want it to be active. You want it to partition well between your bloodstream and your fat layers. So there are a whole lot of things to think about. And what we want the model to do is actually change the structure of this initial drug and go towards something that we can make and something that will be very good against virus. And this is actually remdesivir. So in the end, what we want to do is we want to use this kind of property predictions that we talked about before, and we want to use it to design new drugs, or at least propose new drugs that we can test out in the lab. So one important thing here is the fact that this also has to be synthesizable, and that's something that Thijs will probably tell you about in another talk one day. But I'll just go a little bit more into that, because many of the efforts in machine learning that we've been doing at MIT is about synthesizing also these drug components. So we have software that automatically proposes ways to synthesize drugs, and we actually also have a robot that does it. So we feed the potential routes to make it to the robot, and the robot automatically does it. So this here, you can see the robot selecting the different reactors. And then later you'll see it connecting different wires, the component is made, and the robot cleans everything and disconnects everything. So here specifically, it's making lidocaine. And this is all based on machine learning, artificial intelligence. Yeah, so now it's making the components and disconnecting again. But okay, that's also where I will end my talk, and hopefully Thijs can continue the discussion on the synthesis one day. But I thank you for your attention.